Sweet 16 little song.
Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you. Ah!
letters that were sent to their mom on Mother's Day. These are things that happen to mothers on Mother's Day. And I'll read the rest to you. I couldn't believe it. He got me what they call the ultimate toilet bowl cleaner.
Mothers, we do appreciate you a lot. So this year, I've been picking on my mom a little more than normal, which means a lot. And she got the first part of her gift last night. It's a nice gift card, so maybe she'll forget about what she's going to get tonight. I found the perfect gift. And I'm like my mother. I hate when you say something like that and then make me wait. If there's anybody less patient than me, it's my mother.
I've had to go to the doctor to get nerve pills.
She's going to have to go to nerve pills. Oh, you already have. Well, you made it through my brother. You made it through my brother and I. You're tough, anyhow. You can handle it. I want you to stand this morning as we begin to sing. Lord, we thank you that you could be here this morning to worship you. And Lord, we thank you for mothers. Lord, I just pray this morning that everything we do bring glory and honor to your name. But I pray that we just allow your spirit to move in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Take care of them. Just be with those that are hurting in their heart. Let them go to you, Lord, and take their problems to you, Lord, and know that you help them get through it, Lord. It's busy the offering. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Continue worship as you bring your tithes.
Oh,
Lord, as we study your word this morning, I pray that we would take it to heart. Lord, that we would use it way past these walls. Lord, we thank you for each one that's here. Lord, I thank you for how much you love us and show us that every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Paul's testimony. You say, how does that deal with your
your sermon this morning, that women matter. It's simple. We've already heard Paul's testimony early in Acts. And now he is telling these people who want to kill him and beat him up, he is telling them his story. In Acts chapter 22, verse 1, it says, "Brothers and fathers, listen now to my defense." This morning, there's no fill in the blank. I'd encourage you to take notes if you want to. These are long points, which are so important. The first point, just because women are not mentioned in this passage does not mean that they do not matter. Understand that God created male and female. Amen? There's no other options. If they say so, they've lost their mind. There's two genders, male and female. And God gave men different roles than he gave women. Men, thank God. Aren't you glad you don't have to birth children? Amen? Amen. Triple amen. So it's up to men. This population of this world would be down to about 20. See, we learn. We have that first, but at the end, I'm not doing that again. A lot of the women in this room didn't learn. They just kept having babies. Why? There's a special bond between that mother and those children. We got to have our grandchildren for most of the day yesterday. My little three grandchildren that were there, Casey 6, and then the two boys, Eli and Aaron, are 3 and 2. You see those roles that they even understand at an early age. When they want to wrestle, do they wrestle people or people? They wrestle people. Unless Uncle T, which is there, unless Uncle T shows up, and then it's more fun to wrestle with your uncle than it is your people. But they wrestle with me, but if they get hurt, do they come running to me? No, they go running to me, Mom. If there's a band-aid that's necessary, and sometimes you can't even see where to put the band-aid, but if there's a band-aid necessary, they go to me, Mom, for that. They go to a woman for that. They don't come to me. If they come to me, that means me, Mom's at Walmart. Because they have no other option. God made us to have different roles. He made us to be different. And that difference is a good thing. I've heard men say, well, if we ever figure women out, it ain't going to happen, guys. Stop trying. If you've been trying, which there's almost every man here is a lot older than me. Y'all learned a long time ago, stop trying to figure it out. Women are different. Man, we're pretty simple. They figure us out just like that, and they use it to their advantage, just so you know. We see that Paul addresses the brothers and fathers. Why? Because the Jewish men were the ones that were in, that was their role. But it doesn't mean that it wasn't important. It doesn't mean that the women were not important. Paul had a mother, right? When Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, had a mother. In Acts chapter 22, verse 2, it says, "When they heard him speak to them in Aramaic, they became very quiet. And Paul said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city. I studied under Gamaliel, and was thoroughly trained in the law of our ancestors. I was just as zealous for God as any of you are today. I persecuted the followers of the way to their death, arresting both men and women, and throwing them into prison. As the high priest and all the council can themselves testify, I even obtained letters from them to their associates in Damascus and went there to bring these people as prisoners to Jerusalem. I want you to listen to the second point.
You can teach and train up your child in the right way. When they're adults, they're going to make their own decisions. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I know this is a different take on this passage. We've read this passage through Acts several times already. Paul was not taught to go kill people. I bet if his mother knew about that, she wasn't excited about that. He was so just dug into his religion, to Judaism, to being a Pharisee, that he wanted to make sure that everybody knew he was the best Pharisee, the best religious man that ever lived. And so he took it upon himself to go out and arrest Christians, the followers of the way, as Christians. He was arresting not just men, but he was arresting women. He was pulling parents out of the house with the children there. He was doing this because he wanted to prove to people that he was the right one religiously, and those Christians were evil and no good. And he had them arrested. We'll see in a moment that he even held the garments of people that stoned Stephen to death. Joel. There's people in this room this morning that you taught your kids the right way. There's people in here this morning that weren't saved when they were raising kids. They taught them in the ways of the world. That's what they did. I tell you, my parents were very strict. My parents made sure I understood what was right, what was wrong. They taught it to us from an early age. But once I left their house, and once your kids left your house, as adults, you no longer have control over them, right? You no longer have control over them. Paul's mother no longer had control over how he behaved. The Bible says if you raise them up in the ways of the Lord, they'll return. We've all heard that passage, right? If you raise them up in the way of the Lord, they may return. Well, they may return way after you're not even here. I can tell you many times of Christians when they buried their mother were not serving the Lord, and then after they begin to change how they lived. That very thing happened for Marty's funeral. I can't tell you how many family members of her came up to me and said, you know, I've kind of slid away from what God wants me to do. And Aunt Marta, this was my relationship to her. She lived a life that made us proud, and we want to live like that for God. Marty won't get to see that, but it's changing. So teach your children. Teach your grandchildren. Some of you raising your grandchildren. Teach them. Raise them up in the ways of God. Doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. But raise them up the way God wants you to raise those children up. He gave them to you. A good friend of mine, Travis Stevens, lived down the street from me. His family was Pentecostal Free Holiness. They're the ones that don't go to doctors, and I mean, it's pretty strict. And his dad would wait until all those women were in his house praying, and he was not a Christian. And he would go in there and drink and cuss and just run the women out of his house. And we knew that, and I grew up with them. Several years ago, I saw Travis at a restaurant after church. And Travis said, my dad got saved. About 6 weeks ago, Mr. Stevens died. I saw Travis Sunday, last Sunday, at lunch. And I went over and said, man, I'm so sorry to hear about your dad, but I'm so happy that we know where he is. Yeah, I got a pretty full quiver myself. And we're laughing and talking. And I begin to think about how blessed I am. How blessed you are as parents that God gave you those kids. You got them. Teach them right. And if you weren't a Christian when you raised them up, you can't help that. But you get to raise them up now as a Christian, those great-grandkids, those grandkids, you get to raise them up in the way of the Lord. It's important. I have a hard time understanding not being raised up in the way of the Lord because I was. I pray for those that weren't, but raised them up. Verse 6. About noon, as I came near Damascus, suddenly a bright light from heaven flashed around me. I fell to the ground and heard a voice say to me, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord?" I asked. "I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting," he replied. My companions saw the light, but they did not understand the voice of him who was speaking to me. "What shall I do, Lord?" I asked. "Get up," the Lord said, "and go into Damascus. There you will be told all that you have been assigned to do." My companions led me by the hand into Damascus because the brilliance of the light had blinded me. A man named Ananias came to see me. He was a devout observer of the law and highly respected by all the Jews living there. He stood beside me and said, "Brother Saul, receive your sight." And at that very moment, I was able to see him. Then he said, "The God of our ancestors has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and to hear words from his mouth. You will be his witness to all people of what you have seen and heard. And now what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, wash your sins away, calling on his name." When I returned to Jerusalem and was praying at the temple, I fell into a trance and saw the Lord speaking to me. "Quick," he said, "leave Jerusalem immediately because the people here will not accept your testimony about me." Lord, I replied, "These people know that I went from one synagogue to another to imprison and beat those who believed in you. And when the blood of your martyr Stephen was shed, I stood there giving my approval and guarding the clothes of those who were killing him. Then the Lord said to me, 'Go, I will send you far away to the Gentiles.'" Now we see how God worked in Paul's life. The third thing I want you to see is pray that God will change your children. Don't raise your hands. Some of your kids may be in the building. You don't want to upset anybody. I have to raise mine because my son's blind, so he can't see me through mine, but the rest of you don't raise your hands. How many of you have adult kids that are doing things that you don't want them to do? We all do. How many of you have adult grandchildren that are doing things you don't want them to do? You got them. Now mine are not adults, so. So what can you do to change it?
Pray.
Only God can change them, right? You can't change anybody but yourself. And you can yell at them, you can threaten them, you can not give them money, you can whatever you want to do. It's not going to work. I have to think of which story to tell because Darren's here and I don't want to get Darren in trouble. Tyler Drake, we can pick on him this morning, right? Darren, you like that?
Yeah.
Amen. From the time Tyler Drake was a kindergartner, he had a girlfriend. I can't tell you how embarrassing it was when I got a call from some of the men of the church that didn't quite really like me too much. And they were at the Senior Citizen Center, and they saw the pastor's little son out there kissing on girls on the plate. Kindergarten. One time I said, "Tyler, what are you doing?" you learned. He said, be nice to all the girls, even the ugly ones, because sometimes the ugly girls get pretty when they get older. And that boy had a girlfriend all the way through. In fact, he had three at one time at the same time. Learned that was a really terrible idea. Had a church girlfriend, a school girlfriend, and a swimming team girlfriend. He went to one of the girlfriend's house for her birthday and didn't realize that the other two girls were her best friend. Howard called and said, can you please come pick me up quickly, Dad? Sixth grade. That boy, when he went to college, I heard about some of the things he was doing, and I was not happy about it. He even went to a Baptist college, one of the Southern Baptist college, but he went there to swim in West Virginia. And he did some things that I didn't like. And as he got older, he still did some things I didn't like. And there were times I'd tell Karen, I'm just going to go to West Virginia and put a wolf on this kid here. Get his act together. And she said, if it did work when he lived here, how do you think it's going to work in West Virginia? Caitlin, who didn't do a whole lot wrong, she made some decisions as an adult I did not approve of. I told her I didn't approve of it, and after that, zipped it up. Why? The more I told her, the more she would do what I didn't want her to do. I watched my grandchildren yesterday. They had their bikes. They can drive down the sidewalk to the end of my property, which isn't far, and then they can go back into the driveway, and they can go to the next door neighbor to his driveway, and that's it. They say, you know, Casey's going to the neighbor's mailbox, which is his brother. So her two little brothers go, right? No one says anything. We finally say something when Casey's halfway down the street, and I said, you're not supposed to go past the neighbor's house right there. Well, you didn't say which neighbor. And I told Stephen, who was sitting there just shaking his head, I said, a child's job is to see how far they can push you and how far they can push your rules. Amen? Amen. That's your job. And most children are really good at it. What's the point? If God can change a man like Paul, who was killing Christians, and he can change his life, and he can save him, then send him to the Gentiles. He was a good Jewish man. He wasn't supposed to be going to the Gentiles, but God sent him to the Gentiles to preach the word of God. If God can change Paul, God can change anybody. Paul said, I'm the worst of all sinners. Now, there's been days I think I'd be on that category, but he said, I'm the worst of all sinners. And yet, God saved me. Pray for your kids. Maybe you have adult kids that are not saved. Pray, pray, pray. Don't stop. Verse 22, the crowd listened to Paul until he said this, and the this was about the Gentiles. Then they raised their voices and shouted, rid the earth of him, he's not fit to live. As they were shouting and throwing off their cloaks and flinging dust into the air, the commander ordered that Paul be taken into the barracks. He directed that he be flogged and interrogated in order to find out why the people were shouting at him like this. As they stretched him out to flog him, Paul said to the centurion standing there, is it legal for you to flog a Roman citizen who has even been found guilty? When the centurion heard this, he went to the commander and reported it. What are you going to do? He asked. This man is a Roman citizen. The commander went to Paul and asked, tell me, are you a Roman citizen? Yes, I am, he answered. Then the commander said, I had to pay a lot of money for my citizenship, but I was born a citizen. Paul replied. Those who were about to interrogate him withdrew immediately. The commander himself was alarmed when he realized that he had put Paul, a Roman citizen, in chains. The commander wanted to find out exactly why Paul was being accused by the Jews. So the next day he released him and ordered the chief priests and all the members of the Sanhedrin to assemble. Then he brought Paul and had him stand before them. Now, that's a long passage. Jesus was sending him to the Gentiles, they decided he ain't one of us, and they began to try to kill him. The last thing, and this should be the prayer of every person in here, is pray that your children will remain faithful to God. Pray that your children will remain faithful. When I see things like my son Tyler being a part of worship teams and working in the children's ministry, it brings a lot of pride to my heart. When I see my son who is blind, who most people just say he can't do anything, serves as youth pastor and plays an instrument, actually playing two different instruments at the same time. Well, it makes me proud. I know they're not perfect, but they're faithful to serve. And I hear that Carolyn, who got really, really hurt bad by a church and stopped going to church, when I heard that she started going to another church, this brought tears to my eyes. My heart was filled. I always thought the things I went through were so hard. But as I get older, I have learned that the things my children grow through are harder on me than it was when I went through it. Because I have no control, I have no way to help them. You have to watch them. If you think this morning, oh, I don't have children, let me tell you, this applies to every person. Darren and Paula may not have kids at this point. And as we've said many times, that new baby box, if someone will put that in there and give me a call, I'll go get that baby. I have the best home in the world for it. But they work with more kids in this town than probably any of us work with kids. And they have swim teams and disability programs. Paul is running the whole place over there with the sports at the core. I mean, she is busy. She has so many kids that she's responsible for. Every one of you have children that you're responsible for. Man, my grandchildren, when they see Uncle T and Aunt Paula, they lose their mind. I mean, they're even better than you all people. That's kind of scary, because I let them do whatever they want to, so they love it. Why? They invest themselves into them. They go to Carlsbad and give a well-deserved and needed break for Melanie from those wild little kids. Take them to get them a hamburger, or take them to the park. And so it affects all of us. We entrust our youth to them. We entrust our children to every one of you in this building. Once they get older, even if they're saved, you still worry about them. I know I do. Pray. And while you're doing it, live a life that you can look at and give an example. Mom and Dad have their 50th anniversary here. We had a good time. There were so many stories that we could recall about how they raised us. And of course, some of the silly things they did, we remember that, you know, candy dishes and that sort of thing, we'll never forget. I remember going to David and Belinda's 50th anniversary out at the court, and knew most of the people in the room, went to church with them, or know them, and, you know, it's their kids and their family. When we were little, we said we don't want to ever be like them. We don't want to be like our parents. So those three boys said, and they all had shirts that said mistake number one, mistake number two, mistake number three. And they wore it. I was just like, okay, this is going to be a fun one. Give it to Bel Air Baptist people. We know how to make you good. But he said, but as we got older, we begin to see your faith. We begin to see who you are. And how you handle really hard situations, and how you dealt with these terrible situations, and how you trusted God, and how you pulled in close with your church, and how you did all these things, and how you served so faithfully at church all those years. We said we want to be just like you. That's a testimony that I want my kids to have. I want them to say, I want to be like him. I want my grandkids to say, I want to be like people. I want to be like me. Not that we're perfect, but they know our hearts. They know what we want to do. I hope you want the same thing. You know, Wednesday night, God just put it together. A few weeks ago on Wednesday night, that's been longer than a few weeks, but Gabe got saved. And it's an awesome night. Last Wednesday, someone who maybe is the youth pastor that's impatient comes into my class, and I'm thinking, and he goes and he talks to Jessica, this foster, and thought, oh no. What happened? I'm thinking the worst, and I'm trying to teach. And then he comes up, and he says something to Karen, and he just comes over and goes, hey, Dad, he stopped me, you know. Someone got saved. Jessica's niece. That's why we do this. You know, I look to the back row and I can see two people who got saved because their son got saved. And even when they lost him to a wreck, it changed him. It took a while, too, especially Art's more strong-willed and hard-headed than I am. But we saw a family change for God. It was a tough situation. But God used one teenage boy to give an example to his family. Change. And it keeps changing as they keep getting more kids in their house, great-grandkids now. I don't know, Jay, you're so young, you might make it to great-great-grandkids. Amen? Amen. Yeah, I didn't call you old this time. Remember that. It's on video. You can go back and listen. Moms, aunts, sisters, friends, coaches, teachers, we could go on and on. Thank you for what it matters. I know the man is the head of the household, or at least he should be. Amen. Amen. That's what the Bible says. I didn't come up with that. That's God. The man's the head of the household. Wives are to submit. See, that was my first sermon, was going to be wives submit to your husbands. That never goes over well as a Mother's Day sermon, so I went ahead and stuck in my text.
Well, we
the Bible also says husbands are to love your wives like Jesus loves the church. He died for us. Don't ever feel like you're less than. God gave you a different role than he gave the men in your life, but you're so important. Without you, it wouldn't happen. I pray you leave here today thankful for your mom, because everybody in here's got one. I pray you leave here today praying for your children, whatever role they are in your life, pray for them.
want you to stand with me as we have a time of meditation this morning, for opportunity to come pray at the altar.